tonight at 10:30. And it's at that point in his career that Arena picks up the Eastwood story right now.
I was offered Dirty Harry, and I turned it down originally because I had to shoot Play Misty. I finished Play Misty in 5 weeks. I was all done with it, and then they came back, and Frank Sinatra, who they had been flirting with about doing Dirty Harry, had just crapped out on him. I said, oh yeah, I'll do it now.
As a television star in the early 60s, Clint Eastwood won the affection of viewers on both sides of the Atlantic as Rowdy Yates in Rawhide. He shared the adventure of making the notorious Dollars trilogy with Sergio Leone, and then formed a legendary actor-director partnership with Don Siegel. He founded his own company, Malpasso, and by 1971, he'd become the number one box office attraction in cinema.
I remember having dinner in London with Dick Zanuck and David Brown when they ran Fox in the 60s. I said, Life magazine has on its cover the biggest movie star in the world. Who is it? And they said, who? I said, Clint Eastwood.
I used to work at a gym with Laurence Olivier, and I asked him, what is most important for an actor besides eyes and teeth and legs? He said, physical strength. And I think the fact of having physical strength gives him the presence to be still.
He's got that indefinable something that is the best in America, I think. We sort of look up to him. He's clean cut. He's strong. He's resolute. He's honest. I don't mean to be saccharine about it, fatuous about it, but he's a kind of chap that certainly at my age, I'd like my son to turn out like Clint.
If somebody were to tell me that this were not Eastwood's creation, that it was just a role that was totally composed before he ever got in front of the camera, and all he did and read his lines, and even if it turned out to be true, I just could never believe it from what's on screen. It just seems to be so much heart and soul and fury. He had a wonderful partnership with Don Siegel, but I think the character and the bitterness and the loner sense of justice had to be his own.
The Eastwood character does express, how can I put it? A new emotionlessness about killing that people feel is the truth now.
I never think in terms of what people's impressions of me is. I can't, whatever their impressions are. I can't think of that. If I thought of that, I wouldn't be able to think of the project at hand.
Caramel, Dave Garner speaking.
Hello.
Hi, what'll it be?
Play Misty for me.
Misty, huh? We have that right on the play rack. Thanks for calling.
Eastwood's response to his huge success was to declare that he wanted to play a small-town DJ in a low-budget film, provided he could direct it himself. The location was literally down the road from his home in Carmel on the California coast.
At that particular time in 1970, not many actors were directing.
And also, I had never talked to anybody who had ever done it. It was very difficult. All throughout the 60s, Don Siegel always tried to encourage me to direct. He says, I think you've got a good eye. I think you ought to do it.
When I went in and asked to do the picture, I said, big deal, and I'd like to direct it. I was with Lenny Hirshan. I remember it was my agent. And Lenny comes down and says, well, there's only one problem. They don't want to pay you part of the deal. And I said, well, that's all right. He said, well, no, I think we ought to have, that we ought to make it. And I said, no, Lenny. I said, I don't blame him. We shouldn't have, I don't think I should be paid. After all, I got to go in there and show them what I know. And if I don't know anything, then they shouldn't have to pay me. And if they want to take a gamble, I'm terrific by me. I'll pay them. And I would have.
Careful now.
Eastwood took the precaution of casting his mentor and recent director, Don Siegel, as the barman.
Hi. He didn't see it.
Oh, yeah? Cry bastard.
Fool's ploy, my man. Fool's ploy. You care to play the winner?
I'll just watch.
My name is Dave Garber.
Evelyn Draper.
Don Siegel, his one piece of advice for me is just make sure that when you come around to photographing yourself in the various scenes that you don't slough yourself, because that'll probably be your tendency.
Care for a drink?
Okay.
What'll it be?
Surprise me.
Blue Driver?
Nice game. Congratulations.
Thank you.
What happened?
I won.
I was offered Dirty Harry, and I turned it down originally because I had to shoot Play Misty. And I said, I couldn't do it. They said, well, could you do the other one later? And no. I said, my chance to direct. I said, I'm not going to forfeit that.
What's going on?
Don't tell me it was asleep.
Well, what else at this hour of the morning?
Oh, huh? I'm surprised his conscience was that clear.
What do you want, Evelyn?
What do you want, Evelyn? What do you want? Do I have to want something? Can't I just come over? Or is it inconvenient?
Wait.
Could it be I've made a boo-boo? Could it be that someone has been sleeping in Papa Bear's bed? Come out, wherever you are. God, don't look at me that way, Dave.
Don Siegel was a great film editor, and I think from him, Clint learned everything about the camera, about editing, which showed from the very beginning that he had mastered his craft. He wasn't just a personality that was standing in front of the camera. He knew exactly what he was about, but I think he always has.
Oh, no. I had executives at Universal ask me, who wants to see Clint Eastwood play a disc jockey? I think they were figuring, well, appease the kid, let him, maybe he'll come back and do three or four more westerns, and six or seven more cop dramas or something. But in reality, they made money on the film, and I think they were pleased with it in the end. Though they didn't go out and push it like one of their blockbusters of the year.
This is the 44 Magnum. The most powerful handgun in the world. And it could blow your head clean off. Do you feel lucky?
With Dirty Harry, Clint Eastwood created a household name. With the low-key release of Play Misty For Me, Dave Garver, DJ, had to be content with an altogether lower profile.
I finished the film, Play Misty, in 5 weeks. I was all done with it, and then they came back, and Frank Sinatra, who they had been flirting with, talking to about doing Dirty Harry, had just crapped out on him, and I said, oh yeah, I'll do it now. Great. And they said, well, who you got other directors tied in? They said, well, we have a guy, but we think it should be your guy, Don Siegel. And I said, why, what's the matter with your guy? And they said, well, I don't think you guys would get along or what have you. I said, well, how do you know? And said, well, we just would rather have you. And I said, okay, well, I'd love it. I'd love to bring Don Siegel over because he's terrific and he'd do a good job with it.
Go on out and get some air, fatso.
Please, no more! I'm hurt! Can't you see? I'm hurt! You shot me! Please, don't! Let me have a doctor! Let me have a doctor! Please, give me a doctor! Don't kill me!
The girl, where is she?
You tried to kill me!
If I tried that, your head would be splattered all over this field.
You now, might say that creating a character like Dirty Harry, who was then going to go on to be so popular, was a smart move in a sense of audience awareness. It didn't feel like a smart move at the time, I have to tell you. There was a lot of, this was the early 70s, 1971, a lot of antipathy to that kind of police character. It was a very polarizing movie. A lot of people really hated it, strictly on the basis of what it seemed to stand for.
Dirty Harry was made and released in the early days of the Nixon presidency, when America was split by the Vietnam War, civil rights, and a perceived crisis in law and order. By an added irony, the film was shot in Eastwood's birthplace, San Francisco, the city that prides itself on being the most liberal in the country.
That film grabbed the fear that, you know, that urban white and urban and suburban white Americans were feeling at that time, and they wanted somebody to turn to and to give them some kind of security.
Where the hell does it say you got a right to kick down doors, torture suspects, deny medical attention and legal counsel? Where have you been? Does Escobedo ring a bell? Miranda? I mean, you must have heard of the Fourth Amendment.
What's shocking about Dirty Harry, really, is the level of violence, the complexity of the violence, the ultra danger. It pushes threat and danger to the limit because it's modern society. In a modern society, you could hurt more. Very different from a Western.
I know what you're thinking, Bunk. You're thinking, did he fire 6 shots or only 5? Now, to tell you the truth, I forgot myself in all this excitement. But being this is a .44 Magnum, the most powerful handgun in the world, and will blow your head clean off, you've got to ask yourself a question. Do I feel lucky? Well, do you, punk?
Dirty Harry is really the transitional film from the Western Eastwood to the city Eastwood. There's a very close connection, particularly in the ending, between what Dirty Harry does and the movie High Noon. High Noon, you have a hero who wants to stand up for what's right, but the people of his community are too corrupt and cowardly to back him up. So he has to stand and fight alone. But at the end of that movie, having saved the community, he then throws his badge away, as if to say, the community is not worth saving. And the same mood is there translated into modern urban terms in the Dirty Harry movie. He takes his badge off and throws it into the pool in a gesture saying, what's the use of fighting for the city? It's all done. The hero's role is done. The interesting thing is that he couldn't leave it there. the Dirty Harry figure and the notion of fighting this hopeless battle for the city again and again becomes the Dirty Harry myth. The man without hope who nonetheless persists in fighting.
They're risk-taking scenes. I realize that there's something in there that's attracting me to that, to at least speculate on that kind of morality. I'm driven by some sort of passion, whether it's misguided or not. And if it's misguided, it makes it even more fascinating to play sometimes. In High Plains Drifter, I was trying to show the character, he drifts in out of nowhere, a mysterious kind of figure. You're not quite sure where he comes from or how he fits into anything at that particular point. They view him with an obvious guilt.
The whole town was in on a bad caper against the sheriff, and the three of us were thrown in prison for it, and so we go back to get a little vengeance and meet up with the sheriff, who we thought was dead.
Who are you?
I think Eastwood's emergence as an artist capable of controlling a production, understanding it, giving it his shape, I would place that with High Plains Drifter, where he's using what he's learned from Leone in particular, but also taking what he knows from watching traditional Westerns, and he makes his own statement with it.
Certainly it goes against everything that we were ever taught in the 40s or the 50s with Westerns, when the good guy rode in, whether it was Henry Fonda or Randolph Scott or Gary Cooper, the good guy rode in, you know he was the good guy. He wouldn't shoot anybody in the back. Don Siegel had that with John Wayne when he did The Shootist. He asked John Wayne, when you see him there, you come up and you shoot him right in the back. And John Wayne goes, I don't shoot anybody in the back. And Don Siegel made a very, very bad mistake. He said, Clint would have shoot him, he'd shoot him right in the back. And John Wayne turned and got furious at him. You know, he's going, well, I don't like that, and I didn't like High Plains Drifter, and I don't like the kind of, you know, and yet he liked me. I mean, he liked me as a person, but he didn't approve of some of the pictures I made because he thought they were too, they weren't symbolic of the American experience as he interpreted it.
I've established a character on the screen that may be rough, may be cruel, may have a different code than the average person, but it's never been mean or petty or small.
I've often thought that Eastwood's persona is honed like a razor on the negative example of John Wayne, the view that the Western is a kind of holy text of American history. He's found a kind of Grimm's fairy tale approach to the Westland, with an emphasis on Grimm, gives it its power.
Clint said, at the end, I want the audience to go, like, who was that guy? And I yell that out at the end, who are you? Because we think, is he the original sheriff come back as a ghost? Is he an avenging angel? Who is he? And he can be anything you want him to be, but he did handle the situation.
It's a wonderful comic, sardonic creation. He has them paint the town red, and then he abandons them.
I'm just about done here. I never did know your name.
Yes, you do.
Take care.
Yes, sir, Captain.
This gentleman, he's a movie star. For the fifth straight year, he has just been named Hollywood's top box office star. Clint Eastwood, welcome to Diner's Place.
The early movies that Clint did, back in the 70s, those movies, if they did $40, $50 million at the box office in those days, that was a huge gross. And in terms of today's dollars, you could almost like double those numbers.
Carmel Beach near Monterey in California. As the autumn day draws to its close and the surfers seek one final wave, a tall, lean figure takes his regular evening run along the shore. He remains unnoticed, although he is, in fact, the most popular movie star in the world. Home for Clint Eastwood is a remote and rocky peninsula overlooking the Pacific, inhabited by his daughter Allison, age 3, his 8-year-old son Kyle, and the lady he married 25 years ago, Maggie. He closely guards the privacy of his family, and he doesn't much like his house to be filmed. There's an ever-increasing danger of burglary and even kidnapping, for Eastwood is a very rich man. It's estimated he can now earn up to $10 million from every film he chooses to make.
If you were offered a choice of Oscars, Oscar for Best Director or Oscar for Best Actor, which would you choose?
That's really a... I don't know, I never have thought in terms of Oscars because I've never been involved in the... I mean, I live away from town and I've never been in a political element, so to speak. I suppose the director, I think directing is much more gratifying.
I think there's a surprisingly dreamy intelligence about him. For a guy who's very laconic and very terse, he's got a really a sort of soulful imagination that he's been able to bring onto the screen in very surprising ways.
Howdy.
Howdy.
Name's Josie Wales.
I've heard of that name. Some said you'd be headed this way. And they said a man could get rich on reward money if he could kill you.
Seems like you was looking to gain some money here.
Actually, I was looking to gain an edge. I thought you might be someone who would sneak up behind me with a gun.
Where'd you ever get an idea like that? Besides, it ain't supposed to be easy to sneak up behind an Indian.
I'm an Indian, all right. But here in the nation, they call us the civilized tribe. They call us civilized because we're easy to sneak up on.
Acting, directing at the same time, man, there is a technique to it. It's a little bit difficult. You get used to it after a while. I guess I'm kind of used to it. I think I've done some of my best work, actually, when I've worked for myself as a director. But on the other hand, I might have missed something along the way that would have been better if it had a more objective set of eyes. You never really know those things until you kind of give it a shot. But the precedence for actors directing themselves dates back to William S. Hart and Chaplin and up through Orson Welles and Laurence Olivier, and people have been doing it for years, and some of them quite effectively. Some of them try it once, like Marlon Brando or something, and tried it once in One-Eyed Jackson and never went back to it, realized it was too much work. Other people thrive on it, so it just depends on the individual.
I'll be down here right next to the handheld guy, and I'll be in the shot.
I found that in order to really get people to act well, you have to be the most relaxed.
I need a belt gun too.
And the director has to set that tone. If the director doesn't set that tone, then everything else is built on chaos. And some directors like to build the energy out of chaos. They get their own adrenaline going out of being pissed off and groaning and mad and everything, but that to me, and it isn't fun.
Okay, next man, very good, that looked good.
Because he knows all the people's jobs. He knows the guy's job that sweeps up the floor and how much work he's doing and how much he's supposed to get paid and everybody else and the whole thing from the, right to the top, you know. He knows all that because I guess he made it his business to learn. He uses very, very little direction. When he does, it's brief, right to the point.
You're all alone now, Wells.
I casually tossed the line off and he said, just remember, you're the guy that gave me this. And I said, that's all I need to say.
The guys start coming in on the right, guys start coming in on the left. You don't even have to motion to them either. They just come in automatically. It's all been pre-planned, okay?
I always liked the story. I loved the book when I read it. I just wanted to tell it. I just thought it would be nice at this point, having done a lot of different kinds of Westerns, but this was one where it had a traditional value as far as you knew from the front what was wrong with the guy. What was burning him up, and then you saw what happened, how it unraveled. There was more saga-esque than a lot of the films I had done before. The fact that he's a warrior that has nothing to live for makes him a very dangerous person. You see all the bitterness and how it all evolved.
I think that he represents a character that we can rely on. He represents a character who is flawed, like most of us are, but who stands up for what he believes, or at least tries to stand up for what he believes, you know. And he always loses something. His main characters always lose something. They always lose something that's very important to them.
Be 10 bears?
I am 10 bears.
I'm Josie Wales.
I have heard. You're the Grey Rider. You would not make peace with the Bluecoats. You may go in peace.
I reckon not. Got nowhere to go.
And you will die.
I came here to die with you. I'll live with you. Dying ain't so hard for men like you and me. It's living that's hard. When all you've ever cared about has been butchered or raped.
At the end of that film, Josie, the ex-gorilla, makes peace with 10 bears. He makes peace with the Redskins. He makes peace with Fletcher, the man who betrayed him.
I guess we all died a little in that damn war.
Josie Wales, I would put on a list of the best Westerns ever made. I remember a very mixed response to it. People refusing to take seriously the message of reconciliation and focusing instead on Josie Wales as a kind of hyperactive killer. It was not the kind of movie one expected to have from Eastwood as we understood him at that point in 1976.
I think the outlaw Josie Wales is perhaps an improvement. He's an extremely mediocre director. He really doesn't know how to dramatize material. The sequences don't build. The films he directs feels very long because there's a static, dead feeling in them and a passionless quality to them.
Pauline Kael was the film critic of The New Yorker and enjoyed particular prestige. She effectively led a crusade against Eastwood and his work. However, dissenting voices began to be heard, not least Orson Welles, who said if Clint Eastwood had not directed The Outlaw Josie Wales, everyone would have called it a classic. Eastwood was also attracting an increasing number of champions in Europe.
I think he has complete control of the medium. Josie Wales seems to me to be beautifully conceived, splendidly controlled. The narrative moves in absolutely the right rhythm and the right direction. It doesn't wander off.
One of the things that I'm happy with Clint Eastwood and his work is his ability to pay attention to people who are different than them, to Native Americans, to black people, etc. In the films that I've seen, you know, I thought, well, you know, he always tries to treat people in this way where he's on some kind of equal level with them.
There are various orphans that have been brought to us throughout the year. This one we think was deserted because he's very small for his age. He's already getting horns coming through. Well, they eat grain and they eat milk out of, they were eating out of a bottle for a while, now they just drink milk out of a bowl. And of course this guy, he likes to get in the middle of every shot, Fred Bassett. Sydney's his name. You want some hay?
He's always loved animals and had animals, every kind, from 13 snakes up to lizards and all sorts of things. He always had animals. I had to take care of them. I was left one summer with a blue-belly lizard and a chameleon and 13 snakes to take care of. And I must say, I took the snakes out in the garden and put their box out there, and they all went different directions, and I never saw a snake again.
I see movies at the local cinema in town, and I watch them with people who are not involved with the cinema business, and so I see how they react, and I feel I get a better look at what reality is around me, and maybe in most the average town across the world.
By now, Eastwood had moved his production company Malpasa from Universal to a modest bungalow at Warner Brothers. His relationship with Warner Brothers, under the management of Frank Wells and Steve Ross, would be unique in the industry. There was no formal contract, just a handshake.
Every which way for blue.
One of the executives from Warner Brothers said to me, come up to me and said, Barry, that movie's unreleasable.
Hey, buddy, are you taking your mother for a ride? Hey, take that up there, baby.
Hey.
So long, ape shit.
We had this country score. I tell you, I never heard of one of them. And I took the film to Tupelo, Mississippi. That was the most incredible screening I've ever seen. It went wild.
Hey, what's your wife? What the hell are you doing?
Let you shut your face, boy.
Oh, what do we got here? A real live macho cowboy.
Get it.
Turn your back on me. Ah!
A think the movie eventually grossed somewhere around $78 million, which is a huge amount of money in those days for a movie.
He's invested his money in large slabs of California, and in the nearby town of Carmel, he's often to be found at the restaurant he owns. It's called the Hog's Breath Inn.
You know, it looks kind of like a British pub to me, and I used to love the names they put on pubs over there. I thought it was had a terrific atmosphere, so I just figured we'd get a name that was a little more outrageous than some of the names they use.
The menu reminds his customers of some of their hosts' better-known films, like Dirty Harry and Fistful of Dollars.
That was all by a former partner. He was a sort of a PR-oriented type guy, and he thought up all these things, a Dirty Harry dinner or something like that, which is, I was a little bit reticent about, but nobody seems to have objected to it. So.
Eastwood shares probably with John Wayne the honor of being the biggest star at the box office for the most years over the course of their career. And yet there's a great difference between the two careers. What Clint Eastwood, the actor, did was use his movie star leverage to give Clint Eastwood, the director, the opportunity to make those movies and explore those themes he was interested in.
Well, I love dreamers. I think it's important that there are dreamers. I think I like, there are important that they're doers too, but he probably dreams of himself in another era as a much more heroic figure than he really is.
I like it when Clint Eastwood plays a character who's kind of hapless. A guy who's really not too smart, not too bright, and that's actually what makes him heroic. And Bronco Billy, you know, this is just this, you know, his pride. It kind of takes him to some kind of other level and gets him into a lot of trouble, but also makes him lovable.
You're living in a dream world. There are no more cowboys and Indians. That's in the past.
Miss Lily, I was raised in a one-room tenement in New Jersey. As a kid, I never even saw a cowboy, much less the wide open spaces, except when I could scrounge up a quarter for a picture show. I was a shoe salesman until I was 31 years old. Deep down in my heart, I always wanted to be a cowboy. One day, I laid down my shoehorn and swore I'd never live in the city again. You only live once. Gotta give it your best shot.
Bronco Billy is another one of those films of Eastwood's that shows his understanding of the history of the form that he's working in, because it goes back to the ancestor of the Western movie, which is Buffalo Bill's Wild West show. And he also understands in that movie that the myth, which is embodied in this show business fantasy, has real consequences. Myths teach Bronco Billy how to be a man.
It was a naive picture, but it was a sweet story. It reminded me very much of a Capra film. If Capra was still directing films when that came along, I assume that's the kind of thing he might have done. And I wanted to do my Capra film.
The fact that at Malpaso, Eastwood can use the same actors allows him as an artist to develop within a company, a kind of institutional memory or association of roles. I would make an analogy there to John Ford's stock company and the way in which Ford, between 1946 and, let's say, 1950, made Western after Western using the same characters.
Bronco Billy confounded Eastwood's critics. After Bronco Billy, he was honored by the establishment for the first time, not the cinema establishment. The Museum of Modern Art in New York invited him to present the film at a special screening. 20 years on from Rawhide, Eastwood still had his home in the tiny community of Carmel on the California coast. He'd discovered it when he spent his national service at nearby Fort Ord in the 50s. His family was here, and when he and his wife Maggie divorced in 1982, she stayed on. He's renowned for being fiercely protective of the private lives of himself and his family. As the world went by, Carmel provided a refuge from the glare of his own fame. All that changed in 1986.
In Carmel, the sun, it seems, is always shining, and those who live there appear to lead a perfect life, working on their perfect bodies. It is also the home of America's top box office star, Clint Eastwood.
Nice day for photography.
Clint Eastwood is running for local office because he doesn't like the bureaucratic way the local mayor, Charlotte Townsend, has been running the town. Indeed, this decidedly affluent community does have some rather odd local laws. Ice cream cones were almost outlawed last year. Frisbee playing and ball games have been banned, and there's even a largely unenforced law forbidding the wearing of high heels.
When Clint Eastwood ran for mayor of Carmel, it became the media story of the year all over the world.
Which serves, among other things, Dirty Harry burgers. Last year, he applied for permission to develop a property adjoining the restaurant, but the local council turned him down, he says, without giving him a good reason. For Clint Eastwood, it was the final straw and among the factors which led him to run for mayor.
Yes, I had had the experience that a lot of people have had in the community of going before the city council, and so I'd watched a very, very close-minded group of people who were not particularly friendly or even courteous.
We've got a system, not much, but we're fond of it. We don't like it when some two-for-a-nickel cowboy thinks he can bend it out of shape.
It's the law. Well, then the law is crazy.
And I don't like it when over the past 4 years we've been reading how we are a Scrooge City, or how we are we hate ice cream, apple pie, and mom.
Because there never has been an ice cream cone ban in the city of Carmel by the Sea. Right after that media-provoked situation came out, while we had a great Carmel lickin' in our little park at the foot of Ocean Avenue.
Television crews have come to Carmel from all over the world to attempt to question Mr. Eastwood. This Japanese reporter, for instance, wants to know about Dirty Harry.
You're shit out of luck.
We tend to think of the star, an actor who's really acquired a very definite screen persona. We tend to think of them, the real person, as being the screen role.
Go ahead. Make my day.
And the persona even transcends and defines a kind of role. If I were to say, I want this role in my movie to be a John Wayne part, you'd know exactly what I mean, or a Clint Eastwood part. The Eastwood type becomes a figure you can use in a cop movie, becomes a figure you can pretend to be if you're a president, like Ronald Reagan. You're a man of power. How will the public understand what your power is?
I told the tax hikers in Congress that if they wanted to send me a tax increase, well, go ahead, make my day. I got that line from Clint Eastwood.
That appropriation of the media figure as the model for what the president should be is, I think, a new thing in American political myth-making.
What will be the first thing you do if you do become mayor? Try to solve our traffic and parking problems.
How do you feel? Eastwood had inadvertently given the world yet another character with whom he'd be irrevocably identified. With an ex-actor in the White House, speculation ran riot all over the world about the extent of Eastwood's political ambitions and the color of his politics.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
I think whether a person is right-wing or moderate or left-wing or whatever, that all came out of the 60s, I think. Most of those accusations came out of the early 60s, and I was doing sort of action-packed people, renegade people. They were still fighting the establishment, but they were and they were still fighting bureaucracy. Now, if that's right-wing, that's right-wing. But I know people who are on the other side of the spectrum who feel the same way about bureaucracy. No matter what government's in, the bureaucracy never changes, really.
Eastwood's term in City Hall slowed down his output, but not the expansion of his artistic reputation overseas. Having been invited to compete at the Cannes Film Festival with Pale Rider, a further meditation on the lone Western gunman, the French Cinémathèque honored him with a retrospective, and the French government made him a member of the Order of Arts and Letters. These were to be the first of many such honors that would eventually be given to him by other film institutes and other governments. But a special place in his affections would be reserved for the After Hours tribute, paid to him by America's finest jazz musicians at Carnegie Hall for the jazz scores he'd commissioned and his passion for the music.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Clint Eastwood, and I love jazz.
I used to sneak down into a saloon in downtown Oakland when I was 16, and I'd play at night, and they'd feed me pizzas and give me all the beer I wanted to drink. Once in a while, I'd get a tip or something.
I went to see the Dizzy Gillespie
projects at Warner Brothers. Without much interest, he made the fifth and final Dirty Harry.
He himself has said that he thought he probably did a couple of Dirty Harrys too many. Clint, you know, at the very height of his career, was an incredibly busy actor, and director. He was making two and sometimes three movies a year. He just was a maniac about doing it. In the course of doing that, the products were very variable.
Another personal project, White Hunter, Black Heart, a fictionalized account of John Huston directing The African Queen, nonplussed the critics and failed to attract the kind of audience Eastwood was used to.
Action.
You can't have regrets. You can't think in terms of regrets. You have to go on with what you've done and believe in it at the time. You believe in it at the time, you believe in it now. If you look back, and the project doesn't work for one reason or another, then it's a regretful experience all the way around, but you can't be that way. You don't, if you start having regrets, then you'll have trouble making decisions on the next time out. You can't do that.
Body of work as a director, just for me, I'm a director, though I see things that way. It kind of eclipses even the iconography of Clint Eastwood for me. The director is really where, because he found his own voice and he stuck with it.
Ways, The Unforgiven feels like the summation of his prowess as a director. So it just seems so appropriate that he would take that opportunity to acknowledge his debt to Sergio Leone and Don Siegel.
Unforgiven is Dakota. It is the final outcome of an old gunfighter called back into active duty. And it could have been any one of those characters from Outlaw Josie Wales or Pale Rider or any of those characters. All of that history that he drags with him into that movie, it becomes a memory for everybody.
I
I didn't think Unforgiven would be commercial. Thought it was maybe too intelligent to really do well. I was playing a guy who's a pig farmer and trying to eke out a living that wasn't really working for him. And my character was not a guy who was the romantic hero. He couldn't get on his horse, he was rusty, the thing. The little comic elements there. It's a brilliant screenplay, one of the best I've ever seen as far as realizing all of the characters. But the part Gene Hackman played, he had human characteristics. He wasn't just a snarling, sniveling villain. He had romantic dreams about sitting on the porch.
Yeah, I'm building a porch here so I can sit up in the evening, smoke my pipe, drink coffee, and watch the sunset.
Little Bill wants desperately to build this house, and I guess that's maybe the clue to his character, is the fact that if you do decent things in your life, that if you're building a house, for instance, that's a decent thing to do. That's what people should do. That anything else that you do should be okay. But that's what makes him an interesting character, is that kind of mean devil.
Now, Little Bill, you will leave me at the mercy of my enemies.
Seen himself as a decent law-abiding citizen.
Enemies, Bob. You been talking about the Queen again? On Independence Day? I guess you think I'm kicking you, Bob.
Unforgiven, I see as a kind of a bringing of the hero down to the fully human level, where violence is not redemptive, where redemption is very hard to come by.
Well, ain't you gonna shoot?
I thought it was timely in the violence of the world. It's not beautiful, it's not romanticized, and it's been romanticized. And I've been right in there romanticizing myself throughout my lifetime, but this script allowed me to present exactly how I would feel about it.
It's a hell of a thing, killing a man. You take away all he's got, and all he's ever gonna have.
Yeah. Well, I guess they had it coming.
We all have it coming, kid.
That's right. I've killed women and children. Killed just about everything that walks or crawled at one time or another. And I'm here to kill you, Little Bill. For what you did to Ned.
It's really interesting, and what's at the core of Unforgiven is the fact that having a chance of redemption, he doesn't opt for redemption, he opts for the use of violence.
I don't deserve this. To die like this. I was building a house. Deserves got nothing to do with it. I'll see you in hell with your money.
And this plays right into the theme of the violence throughout Clint Eastwood's pictures, where he seems to be really interested in what the roots of violence are, where it comes from, what are we as human beings, you know? And in this picture, he's just brutally honest and frank. That's what makes it a great film. There isn't a cop-out.
He understands a lot throughout his career about what the role of the hero means to other people, means to American society. How limiting that is in a way, how valuable it is to kind of break out of that and be able to admit to mistakes, to try to atone for them, to try to somehow make things better, even though it's sometimes in the later part of one's career or one's life. There's something very moving in that way that he has done.
And then suddenly with Unforgiven, the whole oeuvre, that awful word I mispronounced, was re-examined, and guess what? It was a huge amount of work that he did that had quality. In Eastwood's case, the recognition didn't come till late, because the kinds of movies that he did were not the kind of movies that critics took seriously. They've been pissing on him for decades.
Eastwood was 62 when Unforgiven won 4 Oscars. He was at the top of his career at a time when most stars are thinking of retirement. Instead, he went on, developing the reflective mood of Unforgiven into a series of films centered on aging heroes.
You know, I've been thinking about the past lately, and I was just wondering what went wrong.
With what?
With me. Core, with us.
The mature characters of the later films confront their missed opportunities and dream of second chances.
I think that Clint's willing to be seen as a grandpa, as vulnerable, as crying over his daughter, as we've seen in a couple of the last movies he's put out. I don't think he has a darn care in the world anymore about how he's portrayed on screen. One of his favorite lines is, at this age, what can they do to you?
I guess there comes a stage when you're younger, you're very reckless, and then you get very conservative, then you get reckless again.
Either had an affair like that or wish she had had an affair like that.
I want to need you.
What?
Because I can't have you.
There was a scene in the film, we were having a big fight.
What difference does that make?
And he was crying. He was very upset, but he wouldn't pushing that towards the Academy. You know what I mean? And he didn't want that scene, I said.
Felt there are only two really authentic American art forms, and that would be jazz and the Western movie. First started, I was coming in. I was sort of an upstart who wasn't at all fashionable in the Hollywood scene, to say the least. Well, I just outlived everyone who was being critical.
It's unbelievable that my baby boy is going to turn 70.
He made his films and still makes them with an air of simplicity, which is really interesting. It makes it look very easy. You know, the acting looks easy, the framing, you know. I mean, it's not easy. but he is like an extension of his own vision.
Mm-hmm.
Stay with us on BBC Two. Play Misty for Me is showing next tonight.